It is a great pleasure to be part of this panel and to be speaking on a book that a very old friend of mine, Akhil Ranjan Datta, has written. But it's a pleasure not just for personal reasons. There is something more to this pleasure, which is that the book talks about, or ostensibly talks about,
Excuse me, sir, please on your video.
That's what I said, that the video is on, but it is not video working for some reason.
It's not working, yeah.
And I hope that more than my visual, my voice should suffice in any case. So
yes, sir.
I hope that by the end of the presentation, the video might as well start working. But that is how we have to live through these odd times when we meet only virtually. So as I was saying, this book meticulously talks about Assam. But as I kept reading the book, in my mind, I kept sort of comparing notes with so many other states, with what Akhil says in this book, that in a sense, it becomes a starting point for comparing what the BJP or what the ruling party in Assam has been doing both in Assam and elsewhere. And it is in this comparative context that the book becomes so very valuable. But to start with the starting point, really, when the BJP emerged as a dominant force in Assam in 2014, it was in a sense something new that was happening. And all of us were wondering how the BJP managed it. The book begins with 2016, because in 2016, the BJP comes to power in the state as well. So following its victory of 2014, the book tells us how the BJP managed to win 2016 assembly election. In a sense, winning 2016 was not a very difficult task for the BJP, because the Congress was in power for 3 terms, and in a sense, therefore, there was a space for an opposition party to take over the reins of the state. Even then, the power of the BJP in Assam signifies rightly its entry into the region called the Northeast. In a sense, the region was so far insulated from this wave of Hinduization and Hindutva both, and the BJP's victory in 2016 breached that limitation. For the BJP, therefore, winning Assam was a major step. For observers and analysts like us, similarly, it was equally important to understand how did the BJP win and what it made of that victory. Because the real task was then to rule Assam, a state the BJP was winning for the first time, and to make the most of it. The book is more about this latter part than about the story of BJP winning Assam. Generally speaking, what the book tells us is this, that combining two strands, the BJP has managed to both not only win Assam in the first place, but win Assam in 2021 again. And the two trains, or the two strands, are on the one hand Hindutva, and on the other hand, a claim to governance. And the book tells us what that governance means. But as I said at the beginning, the moment I read about this, I realized that this is exactly what the BJP would be doing whenever it makes a new or fresh entry. In my own state, Maharashtra, the BJP did not come to power for the first time in 2014, but it did come to power for the first time in a different avatar from what it was in 1995 when it first came to power. And that time in 2014, when the BJP came to power in Maharashtra, the claims were exactly similar. In fact, it was more an emphasis on governance than anything else for the 5 years that the BJP was in power. And therefore, the book rightly scrutinizes less the rhetoric of the BJP, less the ideology of the BJP, and more its claims to governance. What does the BJP do in Assam during the 5 years that it got power is something that the book very carefully scrutinizes. Professor Anupama Roy has already pointed out the importance of the discussion on NRC that the book has brought forward. And the important point that the book makes about this is not just the breaching of the consensus, but the building of a new consensus that Assam may have to live with for the time to come. Let me therefore move on from that chapter to the other chapter, which also Professor Roy spoke about, but I like that chapter much more for a very different reason, and I will tell you why in a minute. The chapter is the chapter on political economy, the dream seller's economy. That is the title of the chapter. The title itself is very attractive, but the chapter is not just attractive, but very carefully written, because it documents the political economy of Assam. And if some student of Assam politics read it, it would be instructive how to combine discussions of electoral processes or political processes with questions of political economy. I like this chapter, as I said, because very rarely in our discussions of political process, we get into questions of political economy. We sort of sidestep political economy questions and only focus on electoral competition, party politics, and probably increasingly on caste equations, or in the case of Assam, it could be communal equations. The book, of course, discusses all of these things. It points out to the various issues that the BJP faces on all these fronts. But through this chapter, the book also tells us where Assam stands in terms of its political economy or its economic development. The book also, this chapter also tells us how the political economy of Assam, in a sense, can be located at a relatively lower level of economic development as well as human development at the All India level. Interestingly, the chapter also tells us what happened during the period which the BJP would like to call the period of black rule of the Congress Party for 15 years. Though the chapter doesn't overemphasize this fact, and I guess rightly so, the chapter shows very adroitly that between 2004 and 2014, Assam's economy trudged along fairly stably, if not very robustly. And therefore, the author calls the white paper that the BJP brought out as a white paper with many black holes. That is how the BJP's rhetoric combines with its claims to governance. In fact, this chapter is very instructive also to understand this question of governance, because it tells us with provisional figures for 2017, 18 and 18, 19, how, in spite of the tall claims of the BJP, its governance claims are probably vacuous. In a sense, the BJP is claiming governance only in 2016 because it was for the first time that the party was coming to power. It had a clean slate. There was nothing for it to show, and therefore it could claim governance. But when one starts scrutinizing its claims of governance of 2016 to its performance between 2016 and 2021, one finds that probably there is very little to report on. And that is the reason why the BJP then needs to go back to its Hindutva rhetoric. So the combination of governance claims and Hindutva rhetoric is predicated on these claims, which are tall, but probably without much foundation. Then the chapter goes on to its title, that is Dream Seller's Economy. There I am afraid that this job of the ruler becoming a dream seller is probably not only restricted to the BJP. Other political parties are probably also doing the same thing. and that is one of the compulsions of political parties in electoral competition, that they need to sell dreams. And unfortunately for citizens, it is the dreams that matter rather than the fulfillment of those dreams. As I would flag on at the end again, I think it was here that Akhil could have probably gone a little deeper into the question of both liberalization and the neoliberal economy, as to how the compulsions of neoliberal economy, in a sense, commit the ruling parties to a certain strategy of rulership. That when you come to power, you begin with tall claims, large promises, many schemes, and then you run into trouble economically, and therefore you slip up on performance. That is the trajectory, probably common. And again, as I said, cross-state comparison comes to mind. And if you compare, let's say, Maharashtra or Karnataka with what happens in Assam, where the BJP comes to power for the first time, one realizes the limitations with which the BJP operates. The BJP operates probably with this basic limitation that it knows that its economic development promises have very many limits for their fulfillment. As a result of which, it has to go back again and again to the same old Hindutva rhetoric and get identified as a party of Hindutva. If it comes to Assam with that burden, then in Assam, it has to create this division between the two communities. It has to turn the governance of Assam into the questions of, say, a security state rather than anything else. In a sense, therefore, at the core of this book, there is this question of BJP's pragmatism and its adherence to its Hindutva core. The BJP has to go back to this Hindutva core, both because it believes in it and because it is pragmatic for the BJP. Let me come back to some provocative questions for Akhil, so that when he writes his next write-ups, either in the public media or in research journals, or maybe the second edition of this book, he will have something on his plate to chew. Three things. One is, at a conceptual level, I thought that for a non-political science reader, the idea of regime probably needed elaboration and needs elaboration. It's not just a change in government that happens when Modi comes to power in 2014 at the All India level. Probably following that logic, the book implicitly argues that the BJP's coming to power in 2016 was not merely a routine change of government as a result of electoral alternation, but a regime change. But even for students of political science, what does a regime change mean could have been a very valuable addition in the discussion of the book. Number two, as I already pointed out in the discussion on dream sellers economy, this bind in which rulers in India find themselves could have found a resonance in that chapter about populism. Populism, yes. The problem that Professor Anupama Roy was mentioning is at the heart of it, which is to convert citizens into arms-seeking beneficiaries. You convert citizens into this, and can there be a regime of rights that entitles us to certain, not benefits, but entitlements, is a big question which probably our ruling classes are yet to discuss seriously. This probably is not limited to the BJP, but the BJP is making the most use of this strategy of converting citizens into beneficiaries and making it politically a successful enterprise everywhere. You go to any state, or to go, you go to the All India level and look at what the Modi government is doing, and you find that this enterprise is succeeding beyond imagination as far as the BJP is concerned. And therefore, the limits and the role of populist politics in contemporary political economy of Assam and India is something that the book will wait for an edition. In the long run, the third question that the book could answer, and I'm sure Akhil is going to respond, and therefore I'm asking this question by way of teasing him: what is so special about Assam in this book? Is it a book that emphasizes the specificity or particularism of Assam, or is it a book that in a sense tells us something which is more general, more all India? And to be more specific, there is a Modi template that the BJP uses: politics, popularity, populism, what you have, but there is a Modi template. Now the question is, with Sarbanand Sonowal initially and Hemant Biswa Sarma now, is the BJP in Assam on a path to have a separate template, or at least a variation of that Modi template, or just a repetition of the same Modi template yet again? This question, journalistically speaking, becomes very pertinent with the BJP changing chief ministers in quick succession in some states, and therefore will Assam then be a state where the state leadership is strong enough to ward off interference by the center, or will the central leadership of the BJP have the last word in everything that the state government does? Are questions which are not just important for BJP's internal politics, but also for cross-state comparisons and for federalization of politics. So these are some of the questions which probably the author can respond to, not just today, but in the long run. And given his long-term engagement with the politics of Assam and with the questions of democratization of politics, I'm sure Akhil would be doing this. And therefore, this is a little more fodder for his cannon. So thank you very much, Akhil, for associating with this discussion. And thank you all for the patience in spite of being...